Hi, I'm Emily from MinuteEarth. And from a distance, the world looks blue and green, and white, and kind of yellowish brown. But from a greater distance, it just looks blue, which makes it unique. It's the only planet we know of that's covered in liquid water. Coming up, 4 short videos for you about the weirdness of Earth's water. Let's dive in with the question, where did it all come from?
Unlike every other planet in our solar system, Earth's surface is 70% liquid water, which, while useful for life, is also kind of weird, because everything we know about how and when our planet formed says Earth's surface should be bone dry. The story goes like this. Our solar system formed from the collapse of a large cloud of dust and gas. The dense blob of gas at the center ignited to form the sun, which, as a young, unstable star, unleashed a fierce solar wind. Over time, this stream of charged particles pushed the remaining gas cloud farther and farther out, leaving only solid particles behind to clump together into rocks, planetesimals, and finally, the rocky planets of the inner solar system that we know today. And here's the problem. Water, in the form of ice, couldn't have been one of the solid particles that stuck around to form our planet, because the early inner solar system was far too hot for frozen water, and any water vapor would have been blasted away by the solar wind. So if Earth didn't start off with water, how did we end up with such splendid oceans? We know H2O wasn't manufactured here over the eons, because natural processes like combustion, breathing, and photosynthesis create and destroy roughly equal amounts of water. And either way, the amounts in question are so minuscule that they can't account for the abundance of water on the planet. Since Earth's water was neither part of the original package nor manufactured here, it must have flown in from far away, on meteoroids or comets or other bodies originating in the outer solar system where they were far enough from the sun for frozen water to survive. The dirty ice balls we call comets are a logical candidate for the source of our water, but were ruled out when we discovered that they were far richer in heavy hydrogen than Earth water. Heavy hydrogen has a neutron as well as a proton in its nucleus, and for every 1,000,000 hydrogen atoms in Earth water, about 150 are heavy ones, while typical comet water has twice that many. These mismatched chemical signatures suggest that Earth's water couldn't have arrived on comets. It turns out that the most likely source for Earth's water is a type of meteorite called a carbonaceous chondrite. Chondrite is just the name given to the class of stony meteoroids that most commonly strike the Earth. But only the carbonaceous chondrites contain water, as well as lots of carbon if you couldn't tell from their name. They have water in them because they formed out beyond the sun's frost line, and what's more, their water has levels of heavy hydrogen similar to that of Earth water, strongly suggesting that these Earth crashers are the source of our ice caps, clouds, rivers, and oceans. And thus, the water that turned our planet into a blue marble came, quite literally, out of the blue.
Okay, so technically, it takes water to make the sky blue, so those first icy comets might not have come literally out of the blue. But speaking of the sky, a lot of the clouds up there look like this. Flat bottom, cloud-shaped top. Why in heaven do they have that shape?
If we wanted to make a cloud entirely from scratch, we'd first need a whole fleet of jumbo jets, or several hundred hot air balloons, to haul hundreds of tons of water up to the sky. And then, somehow, we'd need to disperse all that liquid into a mist of droplets small enough to float. In short, it wouldn't be easy. And yet, our atmosphere manages to pump out one cloud after another all over the world, at altitudes of up to 20 kilometers above sea level, using water and fuel carried all the way from Earth's surface. Cumulus clouds, for example, get their start when solar energy evaporates water from oceans, plants, and soil by breaking the bonds that hold water molecules together. As the patch of air above collects moisture and heat, cooler, heavier air sinks around it, pinching it off and pushing it aloft like an invisible hot air balloon. Surprisingly, this balloon's cargo doesn't weigh it down. In fact, the more water vapor it collects before liftoff, the lighter it gets. As weird as that sounds, it's because water vapor is a gas, just like the nitrogen and oxygen that make up most of the atmosphere. Basic physics dictates that a given volume of gas has the same number of molecules regardless of what those molecules are. And water is made of H plus H plus O, which is lighter than both two N's and two O's. So warm humid air is even more buoyant than warm dry air. As the invisible balloon goes up, the falling pressure outside allows it to keep ballooning, which spreads out its internal heat and lowers its temperature. Eventually, the air at the top cools enough for the water vapor there to condense into droplets, which look from afar like a thin wisp of cloud. And as the rest of the balloon rises, water vapor continues to cool and condense at the same altitude, creating a flat-bottomed cloud that appears to grow upward out of nothing. What's more, as the condensing water vapor molecules bond together into liquid droplets, they release the energy they absorbed from Earth's surface when they evaporated. This heats the surrounding pocket of air, giving it lift and sucking more moist air up behind it, which cools and condenses and releases heat, which fuels lift and strengthens the updraft. Even in a small cumulus cloud, the total energy released from condensation is huge, equivalent to about 270 tons of TNT. And if the supply of water vapor is much larger, the energy released can produce stratosphere-high pillars of cloud with violent updrafts, fierce electrical storms, and grapefruit-sized hailstones. Not good weather for hot air ballooning.
But if you've ever been up in a hot air balloon, or more likely a plane, and gazed down at Earth, you may have noticed that a lot of the rivers look like this. Why?
Compared to the whitewater streams that tumble down mountainsides, the meandering rivers of the plains may seem tame and lazy. But mountain streams are corralled by the steep walled valleys they carve. Their courses are literally set in stone. Out on the open plains, those stony walls give way to soft soil, allowing rivers to shift their banks and set their own ever-changing courses to the sea, courses that almost never run straight. At least not for long, because all it takes to turn a straight stretch of river into a bendy one is a little disturbance and a lot of time. And in nature, there's plenty of both. Say, for example, that a muskrat burrows herself a den in one bank of a stream. Her tunnels make for a cozy home, but they also weaken the bank, which eventually begins to crumble and slump into the stream. Water rushes into the newly formed hollow, sweeping away loose dirt and making the hollow even hollower, which lets the water rush a little faster and sweep away a little more dirt, and so on and so on. As more of the stream's flow is diverted into the deepening hole on one bank and away from the other side of the channel, the flow there weakens and slows. And since slow-moving water can't carry the sand-sized particles that fast-moving water can, the dirt drops to the bottom and builds up to make the water there even shallower and slower, and then keeps accumulating until it becomes new land on the inside bank. Meanwhile, the fast-moving water near the outside bank sweeps out of the curve with enough momentum to carry it across the channel and slam it into the other side, where it starts to carve another curve, and then another, and then another, and then another. The wider the stream, the longer it takes the slingshotting current to reach the other side, and the greater the downstream distance to the next curve. In fact, measurements of meandering streams all over the world reveal a strikingly regular pattern. The length of one S-shaped meander tends to be about 6 times the width of the channel. So little tiny meandering streams tend to look just like miniature versions of their bigger relatives. As long as nothing gets in the way of a river's meandering, its curves will continue to grow curvier and curvier until they loop around and bumble into themselves. When that happens, the river's channel follows the straighter path downhill, leaving behind a crescent-shaped remnant called an oxbow lake.
Or a billabong.
Or un lago en herradura.
Ou un bras mort.
We have lots of names for these lakes, since they can occur pretty much anywhere liquid flows, or used to. Which brings up an interesting question. What do the Martians call them?
Okay, so that picture of Mars you just saw, there's something weird about it that we didn't get to the bottom of until after we made that video. Check it out.
A little while back, Henry made this great Minute Physics video about how the weird symmetry of light and shadows on a landscape can make it really hard for your brain to tell which features are popping out and which ones are dented in, especially if you're not sure where the light is coming from. This reignited an old debate we had here at Minute Earth about this photo of the surface of Mars. That sinuous pattern on the landscape is an ancient stream channel, which is cool because it means that liquid water used to flow on Mars. But that crater above it has a shadow in the top left, which means that the light in the image must be coming from the top left, which seems to suggest that the stream channel is actually sticking up above the surrounding landscape. But that can't be right, right? I mean, river channels should obviously be valleys since they've been carved into the ground. This seemed like such a basic fact to me that even when everyone else on my team said they saw this as a ridge, my brain kept telling me it was a valley. It turns out that not only was my brain lying to me, but this stream channel is an example of a really weird geological process that essentially turns landscapes inside out, creating inverted relief. If you live in a cold climate, you may have actually seen something like this happen with compacted footprints in the snow. As the sun melts the fluffier snow around them, they can end up sticking out, like this. The same thing can happen to a river valley. For instance, say you've got a stream running through a desert. Sometimes there's so little rain that the stream dries up. As it does, some groundwater is actually drawn upward by capillary action, and as it rises and evaporates, dissolved minerals in it are left behind and precipitate out, coating the sediments in the riverbed and cementing them together. As the stream flows and dries up over and over again, more and more cement accumulates, making the riverbed harder and more resistant to erosion than the surrounding rock. Over the eons, wind erodes that softer rock, turning the channel into an inverted version of its former self. We can't know exactly how this riverbed got turned inside out without getting down on the ground and digging around a little, but we can make some pretty good guesses by studying inverted relief on our home planet. You can even find your own examples on Google Earth. Just be warned that trying to figure out what's right side up and upside down will turn your brain inside out.
Enjoy your trip down the Google Earth rabbit hole, and thanks for watching.